You are listening to RFM, Cab Talk, sorry, on RFM. Could be done. Welcome to Cab Talk.
Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad.
The Citizens Advice Bureau is where you talk and we listen.
Other things just make you swear and curse.
But here on Cab Talk, we talk and you listen.
The Citizens Advice Bureau.
For your free, helpful advice.
When you're chewing on life's gristle, don't grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best.
Cab Talk.
Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing.
Good morning, and sorry for that little bit of a hiccup of a start, Westley. I'm getting a bit rusted around behind the controls.
That's all right, Moira. We can take it in turns.
Yes.
Now, this morning, we are hopefully going to have a guest, but in the meantime, we're going to have to tell you what we do at CAB.
Mm.
Yeah. And what is the most important thing about CAB?
It's you can call us for... You can, not sure, ask us anything that you want to find out or want to know. And that can be from, I know, Easter in 2026 to what's going on in the community or keeping up to date with, I suppose, new tenancy.
Yeah,
tenancy agreements. Changes. There's always changes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Mm. And this is the most important thing at the moment with COVID and all the things that are going on in the community, mm-hmm. that we are there to help you with those tricky situations.
Yes, and then you probably see a big smile just being on our faces as our guest has walked in.
Well, I'd like to introduce our guest, Steve Thompson. He's in a rush. I think he is a man that is always in a rush. So we're very, very lucky that he's managed to squeeze in the time to come and talk to us and for our listeners to find out a bit more about his role as a coordinator, facilitator of the Rural Community Trust.
It's quite a mouthful.
Welcome, Steve.
Welcome. Glad to be here. Sorry I'm running a bit late, but I have to say that relatively often for some reason.
That's all right.
Yep.
We're often... we're not very often are we late,
no.
But at times we struggle to get ourselves set up and going.
Yep.
Other things just seem to crop up and... get in the way.
Well, I thought it was going to be very, very easy because I've been to our FM several times down in Queen Street and I never even thought it had changed. So I just went wandering off down there.
Oh, there's a few changes though.
Yeah, got outside, standing outside where I thought it was and thought, oh dear.
Well, you could have reclined in one of their big safe sofas.
Yeah, that's right. So then I got in a bit of a panic. So looked it up on Google, but that still didn't have an address.
No.
So I thought, darn, where is it?
Never mind, you're here now.
That's good.
Yes.
I asked around.
So take a deep breath and settle.
Yeah.
And then we can ask you to introduce yourself and explain more on your mouthful of role that you do out in the rural
community.
Yes.
This morning I was doing a bit of research and I was blaming my my printer because I could not print this off in the large size, so you need a magnifying glass.
Oh, does that tell me about myself? Oh, you're
no,
talking
but
about
you're
Jane.
Not, you're not well, there. Why
I'm
aren't
not
you
there.
There?
Oh, I'm not actually, neither is Sarah.
So you might need to update it.
I was going to say that, but then I thought
Those are the coordinators. I'm not a coordinator.
No.
I'm a facilitator.
Okay. All right. So what does that involve then, Steve?
Facilitators just one level behind the these guys, the coordinators. So the coordinators, they get the 0800 calls because every area has its own 0800 number, and then they delegate it to one of the facilitators to deal with it.
So, i.e., if someone is struggling or having issues in the rural sector, they can contact.
Yeah, well, if they rang the Wairarapa 0800 number, they'd get John Roberts. And of course, you all know John Roberts used to work at Rosewood Funeral Home, so he's been around the Wairarapa for a long, long time.
No, I didn't know that.
Okay, no. John, he's the coordinator for the Wairarapa, and then we've got Sarah Donaldson. I presume you all know Sarah, do you?
No.
She's our clinical psychologist that works with us. And then there's me, and I'm the jack of all trades, master of none. So I sit at the bottom of the pecking order.
So you're the man who runs about everywhere. And
yeah, it's funny, you know. It's actually quite different in the fact that probably 90% of my work comes in just through people ringing me, not the trust. So. Yes. So I don't get much of my work through the trust, but I do work with them, yeah, for different.
So word of mouth has sort of got around that you're the guy to go to if.
Yeah, well, you know, when I started farming back in 1984, started farming back in the early 70s, but I was brought up in Nainai, and had an uncle that was farming in Taihape, so I went farming through him, and when I left school he gave me a horse and a few dogs, and I just went working up Whanganui River and Taihape mustering sort of thing. Came to the Wairarapa managing a property for Tony Lawrence at Tanawa, and actually just did his funeral last year. Yeah, so that's how I got to the Wairarapa and ended up getting the opportunity to... I met my wife after a car accident. I was in a car accident and...
So she came to your rescue, did she?
No, she didn't. She was working as a trainee engineer in Wellington for the Ministry of Works, and she just happened to be home on the farm for the weekend, and they... and we ended up going to her parents' place before they rushed me into hospital to... because we had to drop someone off, and they couldn't be bothered waiting for the ambulance to take me to hospital, so they'd bundle me up and chuck me in the back seat of a car. So we went into her place, and then on the way home we had to call in and pick up somebody, and that's how I met her. She was home and I had my head stitched up, and yeah, so.
And that was the start of you straightening out.
Well, don't know about straightening out, but yeah, so we ended up getting married and going to work for a guy called Sam Strawn, who'd just finished being an All Black at that stage, and we spent 5 years managing a farm of his in Apiti in the Manawatu. And and then Jen's parents, who were farming at Bushgrove, they said that they didn't want to carry on, and were we interested in buying it? Or coming back and working with them, and I said, oh, I wasn't that interested in that. I wanted to do something for myself. So in the end, we ended up getting a rural bank loan and buying the property off Jen's parents because I was eligible for an 85% loan.
So that got you...
So that got us into farming, but with a very heavy debt. And then, of course, we hit 84 Labor government, and we had an interest rate of 4.5% with the rural bank. And that went to 17.5 and then 27.5 over the next year.
That was a real cutthroat time, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. Very tough time, actually. Mm. Real tough time for us. And we actually, unfortunately, saw a lot of our friends in the area lose their farms. Yeah, it was very sobering time.
Been through it, too.
Yeah.
Know exactly what it's like. Yeah.
Yeah, so we battled on, and we were very lucky because Jen's dad sort of came back and helped us, and so we didn't have to employ staff, which was quite a big property, and we did. So we we did all our own shearing and all sorts of stuff, and then we hit the 88 drought, and I just plunged into depression, and couldn't see any future, anything like that. So I had to give up farming for a while, for a couple of months. We went away and just toured around New Zealand doing a few things, and it was a pretty tough time through 88.
And do you think just getting away and being able to come back to look at it in a different perspective just helped a bit?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Getting away and letting the antidepressants start working was a real big...
All that anxiety of somebody else, well, not worrying so much about it, or was it somebody else took over the reins for a while for you?
Jen's parents were able to step back in again and take over running the farm, and we had a really good farm advisor at that stage, Chris Garland. So Chris and my father-in-law kept the place ticking over. And it led to a real long, probably 6 months of real soul searching for me. And I just believed there had to be more to life than, we were working from dawn till dusk, and no matter what you did, things never got any better. And so, I had to do a lot of soul searching, and that's actually what led me to Christianity. I just believed that there had to be something better in life, and I just sort of read of books on different religions and stuff, thinking there must be something here, and actually came back to Christianity. I just believe that God created us all, created my farm, created me to farm it, but he gave me a set of different gifts to some other farmers, and I didn't know what those gifts were, but I set about trying to find them out. And I started off by trying to find out what depression was, because nobody would talk about it, and I was very lucky. I had a young I'm just trying to think what she's called, from the Marsden Hospital, a young English girl, and I'm pretty sure she was only on loan from England, but she was really good because she taught me how to relax and how to say no, and there's a few things she taught me.
Actually, coming back to how saying no, a lot of people, and I actually can relate back to myself, it can be very hard sometimes saying no, and it's almost like you have to allow yourself it's okay to say
no.
It's a big thing, actually, isn't it? And it's okay to say no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm okay, you're okay. That's the thing. And if I want to say no, that's fine. I've said no. You know, what my reason is for saying no is my reason, but I've said no, and that's it. So, and I wasn't very good at that. And I must admit, even now, you'd probably say I'm not very good at saying no, but it's, I've learnt how to not control myself, but I've just learnt to live with it. And really, I haven't had any major problems since 88, really. I was pretty bad in 88, but I was never suicidal. But I was pretty down, and life had lost all its, it was just a black hole that I was in, and but I slowly worked my way out of there, and a lot of it was, like I said, Christianity. I just believed that God wanted me to, he wanted to use my gifts and skills. I didn't know what they were at that stage, but, and I also wanted to find out more about depression, because like even the GP, if you asked about, well, what do you mean, they just go, oh, well, actually, we don't call it depression. I can remember the GP telling me, we don't call it depression, we call it nervous breakdown, nervous suffering, sort of thing. And
That's a very old term, because I remember way back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, they used to say, well, the person had a nervous breakdown.
Yeah.
You know, that was the thing. But then I think that was then squashed, because they realised that actually, no, it's not a nervous breakdown. They just need time to, I think, again, as you said, it's almost like you need time to stop and re-gauge everything and find yourself again. You get, I think, so busy and you just life. Mentally yep. just keep go, and then you hit the brick wall and you think, I can't do this anymore.
Mm-hmm. No, and which then, is what happened to me. Yeah. And, then, and I thought I'd had a heart attack, but I hadn't. I just, it was just, what do they call it? Palpitations.
Yeah.
Caused by stress.
Anxiety. Yeah.
Anxiety. Mm-hmm. So I, I worked my way through all that and learned about depression. And
so you, have you found out what depression is yet?
Well, depression to me is just a, it's just your body dealing with the amount of stress that's on it. What it does is shut itself down, basically. It just says, look, I can't deal with what's happening anymore.
Yeah.
Bang.
It's like a, I think in a way it's like a safety valve, isn't it?
Yeah, safety valve for the body.
Because it actually said, no, you've got to stop. You've got to, what are you doing? It's not working. You've got to stop.
Stop and slow down.
So
we've
got to stop for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I reprioritised my whole life. It used to be farm, farm, farm. And I changed it to my relationship with God, my family, and then the farm.
Priorities change.
So I changed the way I focused on things, and I sat down with the family and Chris, and we had a big discussion about it. And Chris said that if you want to carry on farming, forget about doing all your own shearing and dagging and everything that I used to do. He said if you can't afford to get a gang in to do all that sort of work for you, then forget about it. So yeah, so I just decided then that I'd just farm as normal and expect God to provide the whatever I needed providing with. So I've been extremely lucky, I must admit. I've had extremely big checks arrive in the mail, just cash checks from people. Just all sorts of stuff has just turned up. It's been, I just found a slither of land that I didn't know I owned. When we bought the place, we bought a whole lot of different titles. And this slither of land that was only like half an acre or something, or a quarter of an acre, ended up being worth like $160,000 out of the blue, which, in fact, I offered to give it to somebody, and they thought I was being smart. And in the end, they caused a lot of problems for them and for me. But the final... it was actually the access to the neighbour's farm. And in the end, they had to buy it back off me. And the valuer was valued it at $160,000. Yep. And that was when I had a mortgage of $160,000 that needed paying back. And I had nothing to do with the valuation or anything. I couldn't believe it when it came back. And the neighbour said, I'm not going to pay you that much for that little slither of land. And then his lawyer and his bank had a chat with him, and they all decided the best thing to do would be just to pay up. So, yeah, and that was when the bank was just about to shut me down on another loan. So that...
that cleared that one,
cancelled each other out.
Yeah.
So I've always thought like that, and I know several times Chris has said to me that he can't believe... the way people have dealt with me compared with the way they've dealt with other farmers that he's dealing with, that he said people just seem to not relax with you, but they just deal with you slightly differently. And but he thought it was the attitude that I brought to other people as well. So, yeah.
Right, well, we'll have a break there.
It's very dumb.
Another breather, and we'll keep talking.
To sail on a dream on a crystal clear ocean, to ride on the crest of a wild raging storm, to work in the service of life and the living, in search of the answers to questions unknown. To be part of the movement, part of the growing, part of beginning to understand. like the dolphin who guides you. You bring us beside you to light up the darkness and show us the way. For though we are strangers in your silent world, to live on the land we must learn from the sea. To be true as the tide, free as a wind swell, joyful and loving in letting it be. Cyclopso, the places you've been to, the things that you've shown us, the stories you tell. Cyclopso, I sing to your spirit, the men who have served you so long and so well. Cyclopso, the places you've been.
Then I think, Steve, you've got on a roll now, and I think we'll just let you carry on with your story.
Yeah, well, where did I get up to? Oh, so I just carried on farming with a different set of values, and which led to a whole lot of different things happening to me, and I guess one of the main ones that happened was I went to a farm discussion group, and I'd always been a member of the farm discussion group, and we were at a farm of a guy who'd basically just lost his farm, or it was in the process of losing it to the bank, and he so we'd had a day on the farm looking around, and things had been fairly subdued, and we're all sitting down, about 20 odd farmers in the lounge, and all about to have a beer, and so we'd crack the tops off our beers, and we're all sitting there having our beers, and our facilitator, I think he was probably Chris, said, have you got any final things you wanted to say to this guy? And the guy sat there and thought for a while, and then he said, how do you know when it's time? And this is only like a 28-year-old guy, or maybe 30-year-old guy. He said, how do you know when it's time to walk away, or have them carry, or actually have them carry you out of here in a wooden box, sort of thing. So everyone who was drinking away, the whole room just went dead quiet, and everybody just sat and looked at each other. No one said boo, and Chris and I had been having a lot of discussions on depression, so Chris just turned around and said, I think this is time for Steve to step in. And so I said to the farmers that were there, I spoke to them about what had happened to me, because they all knew that I hadn't been shy in talking about it over the last probably a year at that stage. So I just told them all, basically some of them would have already known, but told the bulk of them exactly what had happened to me and how I'd got myself out of it, and whatever else. And so we ended up having a beer, and everyone disappeared. Like, we'd normally have several beers, but that particular night everyone only had one beer and then just vanished. The room emptied out pretty quick. But the funny thing I found was that over the next two or three days I had a ring from about six wives out of the guys that were there that night, who thanked me for what I'd said, because They'd been dealing with nervous breakdowns with their husbands, but their husbands didn't want anyone to know about it, so everything had been kept hush hush.
Yes.
But for the first time ever, they'd come home after I'd got up and said my bit and talked about it with their wives, and their wives couldn't believe it, that where the heck did this come from? And I had six of them ring me over the next few days just to say thank you so much for breaching the subject.
It was almost like a shame was put onto people if they were coping or they were going through difficulties. It was almost like, you know, society perceived it as as you said, a nervous breakdown. It was like hush hush, wasn't it?
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Mental problem. Yeah.
We don't talk about it, you know.
Stuff up the lip thing, wasn't it?
Mm. It was.
Yeah, and today there's still a little bit of that stigma about. But I think we are slowly beginning to break through.
Oh yeah, it's certainly improved a heck of a lot. So so that led to me. Led me down two different directions. First of all, it led me to get more and more phone calls from people, because the word would spread, not from the guys, but actually from the wives would started talking. So next thing you know, I'd have wives from the Manawatu and Hawke's Bay and round the Wairarapa ringing me, asking me questions about depression, explaining their husband to me, could he be depressed? And some of them were really struggling dealing with their husband, so I'd say to them, okay, well, do you want me to come and pay him a visit? And she'd say, I don't know that he's going to handle that too well. And I said, well, look, I'm another farmer. I'm a straight talker. I'm more than happy to come and see him if you want me to. And she'd say, oh, well, actually, don't tell him that I've told you or anything. And so it was very easy in my parish, because at that stage, in 1989, just a year after I'd had all these problems, the vicar of Tanui left, so we had no vicar, and I started doing a few bits and pieces that the vicar used to do, and part of that involved doing the visiting for bereavements and stuff like that. So I'd taken over doing that, and so therefore I had an excuse to go around and see guys. So
just passing.
So yeah, I'd say I'm just passing. I saw you working in the yards. Come and have a chat. So what I'd do is just get in the yards with them and just keep asking questions until they'd suddenly spill the beans. And I can think of one guy I spent 2 hours with once at the school bus turnaround point, because he just dropped his daughter off, and I knew he was struggling with depression, but he wouldn't talk about it. So I pulled up beside him and parked my car so he couldn't get his Land Rover out. So we talked for two, it took me 2 hours before he finally just looked at me and burst into tears. Yeah. And
for you, it's like, great, now we can do something. And for the other person, they think, oh my God, that mixed feelings. But in some ways, it's a relief as well for that person to finally be able to say, I need help.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, we didn't have a vicar, so the community had asked me if I was interested in training. So through the 90s, I trained. As a priest, I studied theology extramurally and New Zealand culture and New Zealand history. A whole lot of stuff you have to do to be a priest. And then I did my priest training in 2000. I was ordained an Anglican priest. Priest in charge of the Tanui Parish, in which I have been ever since. So, so that's a whole new different sort chapter. Of thing too. But it's but the whole way through I've been working with guys, you know, probably I can go for 2 or 3 months and not hear from anybody, but I can get 3 or 4 calls in a fortnight, sort of thing. Bang, bang, bang. It's just, you just never know when it's going to happen.
And do you I suppose in hindsight you can see it, there's a build up when things are not happening, like now with COVID and
I suppose not as many guys now as I used to deal with, probably, and that's because there's more people talking about it now. Everybody's fairly au fait with it, but in saying that, you'd be staggered the guys that you come up against that have totally slipped through the cracks, and they'll just pop up in front of you one day.
We're very good at covering up, aren't we?
Yeah, I've
never... You know, people are very good at covering up, and you think the guy in the room, the big jolly guy, the ones who are always laughing and joking, actually can be the saddest person in that room.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. And the actual laughing and joking is his cover.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so if somebody says something serious to you, you actually crack a joke and ignore it, bury it. But it's... it's... I suppose everybody's got their... I mean, everyone's different, and that's the one thing I find working as a priest, that because I do a lot of baptisms and a lot of weddings and a lot of funerals now since I've retired off the farm. And, you know, you meet a lot of people. I just believe God's created us all as total individuals, and yet society tries to make us all be... in the same box, so we all do the same thing, and we all do this, and we all buy the same coloured shirt with the right logo on it, whereas we're not. We're all supposed to be individuals, and we've all got different gifts and talents, and that's what I say to parents when I'm doing baptisms, is that what you've come here today to baptise this child is actually what you've come before God to say that you are going to help discover the talents and gifts that God's given that child, and help him to use them and know them himself.
Yep.
That's what I talk to families about. Because we're all different, and I've found a swag of gifts in my repertoire that I never knew existed back in the 80s and 90s. And it's encouraging, and I totally believe that that's my job as a priest, is to get along beside people and show them that they are a gift from God and that they've got talents, and they've been given those talents for the betterment of their family and their community, and they need to use them. If they've got them, use them. It's because we need them to.
We're here for a reason. We just sometimes have to dig to find out what that reason is.
And everyone's special. Yeah. Everyone's got a special, unique set that no one else in the world's got. There might be somebody that looks like you in the world somewhere.
Yes.
But... my wife would probably be horrified at that, but
we all say we have a twin somewhere as
well. Yeah, that's right. But you know, I just run into some really neat people. Like, and the good thing I find about a lot of the guys I've dealt with now is that I can ring them now and say, "Hey, look, I'm dealing with another guy at the moment, and I've got another two guys I'm working with at the moment. How about you visit this other guy? You know what we've done," and they're really good at getting alongside other guys.
That peer support thing,
definitely. And it's the same with I find that with you know, certain types of bereavement. Like if you've got a guy that's lost his son and you've done the funeral and you've worked with the family, and you have another guy that loses his son, then if you can get those two together, it's amazing, because, you know, nobody... I haven't lost a son, so I can't comment. I can't say about how he might be feeling. I'm going to support him and I'm going to help him, but I don't know what it's like. I've got no idea, and I don't even want to start even thinking about it, because it's not me. But if I know a guy that I've worked with 5 years ago in the same situation... then what I'll do is get the two of them together and say, "Hey, you two need to sit and talk. Can you?" Or I'll ring the one that's 5 years ago and say, "Hey, can you get alongside this guy for the next few months and just be there for him?" And it works well. Yeah. Works really well.
Yeah, I think you're right. That people who have literally walked the talk, as I say, you know, you can't match it.
No.
And I think just by... sometimes there's no words being talked at a time, but just the two of them know that they're both in the same place, really.
As I say to people, especially with things like bereavement, you talk about the words. I say to people, people go, "Oh, jeepers, I'm not going around there. I wouldn't know what to say." But I just say to them, "Look, just go. Don't have to say anything.
Just be there.
Give them a hug. Don't say anything.
Just be there."
Yep. Yeah. And that makes a way bigger difference than not going. Because I know people tell you that... ladies that have lost their husbands or guys that have lost their wives, when they're in the main street of Marston and they're walking down the main street and they see people they know swapping sides of the road. And one guy told me once that that's the most gutting thing he's ever you know, all he wanted the guy to do was shake his hand, but they panic when they see you and think, oh, I don't know what to say to him. So they
cross over
the road, or they go down an alley, or and it's just getting people not to do things like that. It's getting people to...
And it hasn't changed over the years, because my mother told me that years and years ago when she lost my sister, and people would do the same because they didn't know how to handle her. Mm. And I must admit, she must have been very, very distressed.
Oh, yeah,
and,
definitely.
And it was hard.
It was hard. Yep.
Yeah.
And often it's the people that you don't expect that would be like that. And it says, is that person, say, I don't know what to say to that person, I'll cross over.
Yeah.
Rather than just say, hi, how are you? Yep. How's things going? Mm. That's all you got to do, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
And I find it relatively easy now, because I just pray about it as I'm driving to the house. Just say, Lord, open the doors. Give me the right words to say. Mm. And if anyone else says to me, I tell them the same thing. Mm. Just do that if you like. It works well.
I always find the sooner you do it, the better.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah. It's the worst thing to do, in my thinking, is to put it off.
Yeah.
If you get on with it, it makes a big difference.
Yeah. Yep. But the hardest thing, if I find when you're working as a doing funerals and stuff, is actually getting some time with the family to organise everything. Because when you're sitting around at the house, there's that many people coming and going, and you're trying to make some decisions, and someone else turn, someone ring, someone.
Mm.
It all becomes a really hard on everybody. Whereas if you just had half an hour, get it all sorted, get away.
Yeah.
So that's why it's easy to meet them at the funeral directors or something.
Yeah.
Away from everybody and turn their cell phones off. Just like I've done with mine when I came in here. Because it'll ring every time right at the crunch. Yep.
Yes.
Mm. Yes. I mean, that's the other thing, isn't it? The cell phones, it's a blessing, but it's also a nuisance.
Definitely.
You know, they do interrupt things quite quickly, can't they?
Yeah, and I drive my wife nuts with my cell phone, because I go to a lot of meetings where I turn it off, and then I forget to turn it on again.
Yeah.
And I might be in a meeting somewhere organising something and turn my phone off, and then come home, she's rung me or left a message, and for me to call in and pick up some eggs or something on the way home.
Yeah.
And she says, when I turn up, she goes, where are the eggs? And I go, oh, what eggs? Sort of thing. She goes, you haven't turned your
phone. We all have that problem, Steve.
Yeah.
I think that's a male problem.
I think it is.
A male problem.
Yeah. I think we switch it off, but we probably do, or just check to see if there's any messages without putting it on again. But maybe you need to have a little thing in the car, check cell phone before going home.
That's right. The hard thing is, a lot of us women still have a handbag with all this stuff in it, so the cell phone goes in there. But men haven't got quite that same thing, so it's either in the back pocket or...
But then you can also put it onto the vibrator to let you know that it's buzzing away, that you've got a message there.
I always find, and I tell people this, that when you're dealing with people, you've got to make them feel special, and you make them feel special by concentrating on them, that whatever you're dealing with them is the number one thing in your life at the moment. Whereas if you're going like this every couple of minutes, which I get it all the time when I'm dealing with people. I remember years ago I had a brother-in-law of mine who worked for Sir Bob Jones. This was 25 years ago when cell phones first came in. And I can remember he sacked somebody that answered the cell phone in one of his meetings. He just said, right, gone. My time's more important than whatever's going on in your cell phone.
It was quite interesting. I've got an interesting story there. I was with my grandson was about 6 at a time, and we were in the bus then, and he said, why is when people come in the bus, they put these things in their ears all the time? I says, they're listening to their cell phones and all that. And he went quiet, then he looked at me and he says, you know, people need to talk to people. He says, we all need to talk to each other.
Mm.
And there was his voice was quite loud, as little voices can be, you know. There was a few people took the things out of their ears and then turned around to the passenger and said hi, and they all, a lot of them nodded to him as they went off the bus. And I thought, you know, from the, you know, his little voice, and it like, so true, we get so busy in ourselves.
Yes. It's like when you sit a couple down and you go through them. I do, when I'm doing weddings, I do a course thing with them now. I don't just marry them like I used to. So for the last 10 years, I do this course thing, and you sit them down and you say, right, what's the most important thing? How long have your parents been married? And hopefully one of them will have been married for a long time and they both haven't separated. Oh, 40 years or whatever. And I say, right, so what is it that's going to keep you two together in 40 years' time? And they all go, love. It's going to be love. And I go, no. Oh, well. Oh, whatever. And they come with all sorts of stuff. And I go, come on, you should be able to guess what it is. And they go, oh, don't know. And it's communication, you know, whether that's physical, oral, signal, sign language. How well you and effective your communication is how well your relationship's going to last. You know, it's you know, once the communication's gone, you give them 6 months and it's all over. And it's the same with people. You know, what's life about? You know, what's the key part of life? You ask someone, what's the key part of life? Oh, I don't know, living and breathing, whatever. But it's not the key part of life. Life is all about relationships. It's not about anything else. It's all about relationships. It's about your well, for me, it's about my relationship with God. It's about my relationship with my wife and my family, and my relationship with myself is a huge part of it. Your self-esteem. And you know, the bulk of the people I work with have got very low self-esteems, and you know, so it's about building proper relationships and communicating even with yourself about how you're perceiving things to be.
Isn't that,
and that's where depression comes in.
Yeah, it's going to say part of depression, because you're so busy thinking of what you're going to do that you forget to listen to the self, do you? And so I say, well, you know, no, it's okay to take a day off. It's okay to do this, and it's okay. I've always believed that there should always be a family day in a family, that everybody is, especially when they're young, that everybody should be together. And it doesn't matter what else is going on, it's family day, and we're doing something together, even if it's just walking down to the river or something simple. It's still family time.
Yep, definitely. Yeah. And the other one is sit at the table and have your meals. Yep. You know?
And that thing's elsewhere.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I just know, like, my youngest daughter got married a month or so ago at home, and we had all the kids home, or one in Aussie didn't make it, but it's just the nights, the meals at nights when we're all yakking. And and I met some cousins of mine in Wellington at the weekend from Auckland, and we had a meal out, my sister, and we had an amazing time, you know. It's just chat when you're doing that sort of thing.
And there's an easy exercise, I always think, at the dining table, especially with children. It's like saying, well, what good happened today?
Yep.
And what bad happened today? And often the bad, you know, things that's happening maybe at school that's not working out, or and it's surprising how much you can just open them up.
Yep. Mm.
And it's almost like if it's done there, it's a safety net as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
Talking, you know.
It's definitely.
Yeah.
And those are skills that are taught by parents, aren't they?
No, don't get me started on that.
Perhaps we'll have a break.
You don't bring me flowers. You don't sing me love songs.
You hardly talk to me anymore. When I come through the door at the end of the day,
I remember when you couldn't wait to love me. You used to hate to leave me. Now
it's good for you, babe, and you're feeling all right.
Well, you just roll over and turn out the light, and you don't bring me flowers.
Used to be so natural to talk about forever. What used to be's don't count anymore. They just lay on the floor till we sweep them away.
Baby, I remember all the things you taught me.
I learned how to laugh and I learned how to cry.
Well,
so you think I could learn how to tell you goodbye?
How to tell you goodbye? You don't bring me flowers
anymore. But you don't say you need me,
and you don't sing me love songs.
You don't bring me flowers anymore. Right,
that was Neil Diamond, Barbara Streisand, You Don't Bring Me Flowers Anymore, and we just realised how much that was probably fitted into the conversation you just had, Stephen, on communication. Yeah,
but, yes. Flowers are lovely. I love growing flowers and picking them, putting them inside, giving them to people. Mm. Just some part of me just likes doing that.
One of your gifts, your talents.
Yes, Yeah.
What do you do that pleases other people, that eases other people's burdens or supports another person as a gift? Talent that you've got.
And a lot of people perceive they don't have any gifts, but just listening to somebody is a gift, actually. Giving attention to someone. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. Often we give the attention to the grandchildren better than what we did with our own children. It's almost like we need to swap things and have the grandchildren first to learn. But never mind. Yeah.
Yep.
So when does wisdom come into our...
Well, I guess I wouldn't be able to comment on stress and depression and stuff like that if I hadn't been through it. So that's wisdom, I think. Everybody, you learn as you go through it. Well, in actual fact, some people don't learn, and you know when you're working with them that it's only the drugs that are working on them. It's not they haven't actually changed their thought patterns.
Yeah.
So you know you'll see them again in 2 or 3 years, and there are people that every couple of years they come back.
And I think that's true. I mean, I think, you know, people sometimes find something to cover up.
Yep.
And they're still not dealing with the actual issue.
The other thing I say to people is that stress and depression is your problem, okay? It's not your wife's problem. It's not your kid's problem. It's not the guy you work with's problem. Yeah. It's your problem.
Mm-hmm.
And when you work out how to deal with it, you'll get on top of it. But until you take the time to work out how to deal with it, then you won't get on top of it, and it'll just keep bugging you all the time. So, and it's interesting because... I don't know, a lot of people would have seen me on Country Calendar about 3 years ago. They did a program on me as I was leaving the farm. In actual fact, Country Calendar approached me about 10 or 12 years ago to do a program on me. But when they started talking to me, they decided that, oh, they didn't really want to go down there and talk about mental health problems on TV. So they decided they'd leave it. And so about 10 years later, they came back again and said that there's a huge big talk about mental health at the moment. You're a guy we passed over 10 years ago. What say we talk to you now and we look at what you've been doing?
And if only they had done that 10 years ago. But then again, maybe it just wasn't the right time.
It wasn't the right time. It's always the right time. Whenever it happens, it's the right time, I believe that.
Yeah.
So I left the farm, retired, moved to town, thinking that I'd retire, but I kept my dogs, so we use them with rural support. Mm. If we've got to support a farmer, I take my dogs if I need to.
Mm-hmm.
I also do a lot of casual working for different farmers who get me in to help for different things. The rest of the time they run along behind my bike or behind me when I'm out walking or riding during the week. And another thing that I've got into since I left the farm is that I'm one of the relief Wairarapa Hospital chaplains.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I try and keep an eye on rural people that are in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
So people that I know or people that other people ring me and tell me about certain people being in hospital. And they're mainly older people.
Yeah.
And I just keep following them up. Mm-hmm. Jollying them along and seeing, making sure that I feel they're getting treated reasonably well. And the other thing that I got into, which has opened my eyes up really way more than I expected it to, is after doing Sir Brian Lahore's funeral, the Wairarapa police approached me about becoming their chaplain. So I'm now the Wairarapa police chaplain, and it's something that I really enjoy, but it's opened my eyes up to the general Wairarapa community that I just didn't know existed, and that's the amount of family harm and violence going on behind closed doors in the Wairarapa is staggering. And the amount of resources that the police put into it is staggering.
Yes.
It's
quite scary, really, isn't it?
And it's so easy for people to be anti-police.
Yes. It is, and it's certainly, I've got such a whole new appreciation of the work those guys do. Well, you know, it's, and a lot of it, some of it can be quite soul-destroying sort of work. And yet they heads down, bum up, and do the job because no one else is going to do it.
No, it's tough.
No. But I've always said that, you know, people might say this about the police, but the first people they call when they need help.
Police, yeah, definitely. And they're an amazing bunch of guys. Mm. And, you know, in the Wairarapa, they're well-led and they're just an amazing, like I said, amazing bunch of guys. So many... You know, when I talk about God's given gifts and talents, those guys in there have got amazing gifts and talents for the work they do. Mm. And a lot of it's not easy work.
And I think the police have gone through their own trials of recognising when their officers need help as well.
Yeah,
and
definitely.
I think I think that's probably enriched the police as well, because I think it's opened them up and make them realise they're just as vulnerable as everybody else to depression and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, we just witnessed them this morning dealing with an accident out on the corner.
Yeah.
And... you know, they just had a really good way with the poor guy whose car was smashed in. It could have been his fault. But, you know, they were really, really good at doing that with them.
They do so much work that's not seen too. Like, you only part of what you see them on the street is only a fraction of what they do in the Wairarapa.
And it's some of the things they've had to deal with is just nightmares. Yeah. And, you know, and I think the fire brigade as well, probably. Ambulance.
Working as a hospital chaplain, the staff in the hospital, you know, they just put in hours and hours of, and it's just some of the work, you know, must be so repetitive, and yet they do it with such a cheerful face and with genuine concern for the people they're dealing with.
And I think it's often the unseen that people don't see behind doors, I think is the important things. Yeah.
And
yeah. But anyway, we're getting very sober here. So Steve, you're probably quite busy, but let's say that if people are out there and they think that they probably could do with maybe a little visit from you or some support, but this is to do with the East Coast Rule of Support, they can call 0800 787 2254, and if they get through to that, they'll be
they'll get a hold of John or Jane. In the Wairarapa. Jane looks after Tauru. She's a hard case
Scottish girl.
Scottish girl, I was going to say. Wee Lassie.
Yeah. And we do a report.
I can show you a weird looking photo of her if you want to see it.
No, and we also do a report of this program, and it's in Citizens Advice.
Yep.
And it's put out to all our cab workers, as well as your information is all on our database.
Oh, okay. Oh, right. So I'm on the database.
Yes.
Hey, so that's,
if you're allowing it.
So yeah, if you do want to contact us, if you, you know, have been listening to us and all that, you can phone the CAB on 06-377-0078. We're open Monday to Friday, 9 to 4. And even if you phone the 0800 number 367-222, the person who answers the phone will be able to give you the same information.
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. But yes, it's amazing how that time has just flown past, Steve. I think we could do another hour quite happily. In
well,
just
they always
chatting.
Say I can talk the skin off a rice pudding.
No. Well, you can have the skin of the rice pudding.
You can have the rice pudding.
Yeah. I prefer a sticky date one.
Oh, do you know? Thank you very, very much, Steve,
that's
for coming
right.
in.
No and, problem.
Very good.
Yes, yeah. Thank you.
I think hope it helps people in the community.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And even not in a community, if you feel that you need support, just going for medical help, go and see your doctor.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's always someone around to help you.
Yeah, there always is. You just need to say, I need help.
Yep.
Yeah, and it's okay
to say you need help.
Yeah. All right.
Advice Bureau is where you talk and we listen.
But here on Cab Talk, we talk and you listen.
Cab Talk,
every Tuesday at 10 o'clock on Arrow FM.
And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps. Just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. Hey,
always look on the bright side of life.
Come on.
Always look on the bright side of life.
For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your scene, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance anyhow.
So always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath.
Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show. Keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And
always look on the bright side of life. Always look on.